Hi, I'm one of the senior partners of Cycas Hospitality. We are a hotel operating company. We own, lease, or manage hotels across Europe and the UK. We are essentially a Dutch company. Our HQ is in Amsterdam, and I hope that's why I'm here. And we also have hotels in Amsterdam. And I must admit, I bailed out of London roughly about 4 years ago and moved to Amsterdam, which turned out the best decision I made. basically, we operate about 14 hotels currently across, two of them are in Amsterdam and the rest are currently in the UK, majority of them being in London. And we have about six hotels under construction across France and Germany and Netherlands and UK. And as I say, we are very much active in the Dutch market as a hotelier. But unfortunately, the other real estate segments, retail and logistics, are currently not allowing hoteliers to open more hotels.
Okay, good. Dirk-Jan.
Good. So I'm Dirk-Jan Gondrie. I'm a partner in the real estate department of Dentons, which is an international law firm with approximately 9,000 lawyers worldwide. Dentons and also the law firm in Amsterdam has a strong focus on real estate. We assist mainly international investors, but also domestic investors with real estate transactions in the Dutch market and in any real estate asset class. And we have about offices in every country in Europe, so that enables us also to contact and connect different investors from different countries that want to do business in different countries in Europe. So.
Okay, great. Lovely.
I'm Arvi, I'm Head of European Investments at W. Carey. For those of you who don't know, we're somewhat under the radar, but we're a large US listed REIT. We focus on net lease investing, which is essentially very much long income, safe, secure, income protected type of investments. We've got assets across Europe in 20 countries, globally about 20 billion under management, north of 5 in Europe. And the Netherlands is one of our largest investment markets in Europe and been there since 2002 and across a whole host of asset classes.
Okay, great. Rogier.
I'm Rogier Ross. I'm heading the Amsterdam office for BerlinHyp. We have offices obviously in Germany, but also in Paris and Poland. We are active in the Netherlands since 10 years, having a loan book of approximately 2 billion. We're cherry pickers and focusing on investment loans. Strong focus on green bonds these days and digitalization internally, and basically serving all asset classes.
Oliver, go on.
I'm Schroders, dedicated analyst for continental European real estate. Schroders is obviously one of the biggest asset managers around. In real estate, we have about 15 billion euros under management. We recently acquired a hotel business as well, so we're now doing not just offices, retail, and logistics, we're also doing hotels. In my role, I basically advise our fund managers, our transaction managers on strategy, investment strategy, and basically helps on a day-to-day basis when we make acquisitions. We invest across Europe, and when I say across Europe, that's for us mainly Western Europe. The Netherlands is a very interesting market for us at the moment. We are not investing in Central and Eastern Europe. That's probably mostly because of the capital we represent. It's mostly institutional money, you know, pension funds and insurance, and sort of for that kind of risk and return, we focus mostly on Western Europe.
Okay, good. Let's start off with you, Oliver. So the Dutch economy has been performing well. I mean, as has you know, a lot of the Eurozone. In terms of economic growth. So how long do you see that cycle continuing in the Netherlands? Do you see that continuing in terms of growth for the economy?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, also connected to the real estate market, because I think I was very much surprised on how quick the Netherlands turned around as a market. I think 3 years ago, we went to Pravada in Amsterdam, and you saw the long faces of most of the brokers, most of the investors saying, like, oh, it's not picking up. The rest of Europe is doing well, Germany, France, all picking up, but the Netherlands isn't. So the Netherlands, I think, Netherlands did lag a little bit behind, But when the turn came, it came very quickly and it came very heavily. So I think at the moment in the Netherlands, we are really in the middle of an upswing. I think it's a very, very interesting market. I see, for example, for Amsterdam offices, but also for other cities like Utrecht or even Rotterdam, more rental growth to come. I mean, surely yields have compressed very significantly. We're talking what you had a slide up here from sales, so 3.5 for prime offices in Amsterdam. You get a discount if you go to Utrecht and Rotterdam, probably just sub 5. But in terms of where the Netherlands are in the cycle, I think, you know, we're in cycle, and I think we're going to have another good 2 or 3 years.
Okay, good. And Rogier, in terms of the, I mean, you're obviously based there. What are you seeing from on the ground? And I suppose in terms of the sort of solid economic growth that we're seeing, how much of an impact do you think that's having on, I suppose, the real estate fundamentals, whether that's, you know, more occupiers for office, better, you know, more people spending money on retail. What's your sense of that?
A couple of things happened. Like in other markets, yields came down before take-up was increasing, and in the meanwhile, we see that increase as well, which makes obviously the market more stable. What we have seen, well, we had yesterday the government presented the budget, and it's noted that there has been significant economic growth. However, not everyone has benefited from that. And there will be measures to have the working class benefited from the economic growth, which will also help retail and jobs. So the fundamentals are actually currently only getting better. And you may still consider the market as stable.
Okay, good. And in terms of, I mean, in terms of, you mentioned at the start there that the Netherlands was an important market for you, and you've been active since 2002. It would be good just to get a sense of how you're seeing the market at the moment. Is pricing getting higher? You've been active though recently in the market, so you're still seeing opportunities there. What's your sense of where you see the market at the moment in comparison to the other European markets that you're looking at?
Lots in there. So first of all, how do we see the market? For all the aforementioned reasons, it's clearly very interesting. As a company, we have a focus on Northern Western European economies, essentially in short form, the stronger economies, and Netherlands is clearly up there. I think there's a certain level of benefit from currently not having quite the political complications of certain other Western European countries, we should say. But it is interesting. I think the fundamentals are there. You have not only, I think a trait you see in countries like the UK and Germany is multiple investment markets. As was mentioned, you have Utrecht, you have Rotterdam. I think that's important. A lot of countries in Europe will have, fundamentally for international investors, really one city where people are investing. Netherlands has a multitude. It's got a good rule of law. It has it has very high population density. In fact, I think it's the highest in Europe, short of places like the Vatican, and all these kind of trends, which are very important, and that showed that's good for continuity, it's good for the future, and it should make the country perform well, and that's why we're interested in it. When we talk about the opportunities that we look for, we tend to find, obviously, it's easy when a market is not as rife to pick off our very, very standard type of product, which I'd love to do all day long. The more busy a market gets, the more creative we need to be. So we're certainly finding, with the high level of liquidity and the, you know, highly transactional market, that we're finding opportunities. Yields have come down on the bread and butter stuff, so we start to have to, you know, either find other asset classes or try and be creative to really generate that that alpha, for want of a better financial term.
Okay, good. And Dirk-Jan, I mean, actually, there's a question that's come in, so I'll pick that up in this as well. In terms of the prime yields and the fact that they've dropped, how much depth is there? You're probably seeing this in terms of, you know, the investors that are coming in. How much depth is there in the market for this kind of pricing? What's your sense of, the range of capital that's coming in and the appetite for pricing at these levels?
For me as a lawyer, I'm only
able to look ahead, let's say 6 months or so, because I can see the work coming in and the deals that are coming in. And from what I see now is that that is still, interest is still very high, and investors are still willing to pay those prices. Also, when you look at structure sales procedures, there is still a lot of competition and investors that are willing to pay those prices.
And Asli, just coming to you, in terms of the interest that you're seeing in your particular sector, are you seeing a different range of internationals wanting to access the market? What's your sense of that?
In our segment at the moment, it's very quite difficult at the moment. We are struggling to find the right hotel deals. Predominantly is that the yields are compressed so heavily, and we are literally competing against office usage, you know, for conversion or greenfield development, even the residential. And although we have quite an interest from capital point of view, be it German pension funds as always, and some Asian empires, currently it's really becoming a difficult to step up and compete against those other real estate segments.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
But I mean, you know, when we talk about yields and how they compress, but we can have the same discussion about, you know, what happened in Germany, what happened in France. Yields are what they are, and they, you know, they've just compressed across Europe in all the main markets. There's no doubt about it, and, you know, it is just capital wanting to allocate to real estate. What convinces me, for example, about the Netherlands and a market like Amsterdam are the fundamentals, you know, things like population growth, which is, you know, very strong in a market like Amsterdam, which sort of creates extra demand, not only for offices, but also for retail, logistics places, and so on. So, yes, yields have compressed, but, you know, if you look at the fundamentals, as the Netherlands, come in and offer that little bit of extra that you can build on for the future. And again, you know, a city like Amsterdam, you know, is, you know, it is run quite good in terms of governance as a city. The city invests in infrastructure. You know, we've just seen a north-south line opening. So, you know, there is sort of momentum in the market, and it's a city government that also looks at, you know, how to develop different areas and different roles. I mean, look, we're not core investors. It's just, you know, we need to offer a little bit of a premium to our investors, and our investors give us the money because we can deliver that. So we've been priced out, of course, of the Schroders, or, you know, of the city center market in Amsterdam, clearly. You know, so for us, it's more about places like Amsterdam Southeast, you know, around the arena, or Oslo today. But, you know, there are opportunities, you know. We're not talking three and a half is a year, yeah, you have to pay in the Schroders. But if you go out, yeah, you get a little bit of a premium for very good fundamentals. And I think that's what convinces me about really some of the submarkets in the Netherlands and in Amsterdam.
But,
yeah.
Especially, you know, I'm talking about Sloterdijk and arena, but like of Hooftop, for example. I mean, Hooftop is right near Schiphol Airport, is accessible to central Amsterdam very quick. And even there, we literally so priced out by the residential demand and the office demand. We have really just focusing on really alternative sort of the fringes of Utrecht, Deventer, Rotterdam, because there's literally that what accumulated inside Amsterdam and exploded, it's really you're seeing the flow going into these very B locations that 5 years ago we wouldn't even look at it and leave it alone, drive there to check the site. Quite often I find myself on along the A2 and A10 outside Utrecht or Deventer looking for a conversion or a greenfield. And it's quite interesting. The dynamics has changed immensely between Amsterdam is the key hub, and how it's spreading now across the main highways, secondary cities.
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at vacancy rates, you know, like if you look at the Schroders, you know, and you need sort of 2,000, 3,000 square meters of office space, it's tough, and it's expensive. I mean, you know, you see the headline rents that the brokers put in their reports, and I think we're talking about 410 now for the Schroders as published. But to be honest, you can pay 465. And for a long time, it just used to be sort of, we all know the chart of the Amsterdam prime rent is just a flat line, you know, 330 or whatever, and what all the kind of leases that were signed, you know, had sort of just different level of incentives in it. But now, for the first time, we actually see sort of the rents really going up. And what you said about sort of the competition, residential, and I'm sure we're going to come to it, is obviously the big success story. you know, the Netherlands and Amsterdam need so much more residential space, and it's really a competition for other uses like offices, like retail or logistics.
Even though a number of developers that bought empty office space, let's say 3-4 years ago, with the objective to transform it to residential, that during that process already have received so much offers for office use that wants to lease that property for another 10 years. And that says that, I think, a lot about the demand for office space.
What's your sense of that, Rogier?
Because those were actually the assets that you mentioned as being under-demolished in 2014.
Yeah.
Both back then, in order to demolish them or to redevelop them, and now being leased out again as an office.
Just for something I'm perhaps going to add from a historical perspective. Yes, indeed, I was on that panel 4 or 5 years ago, and it is only 4 or 5 years ago. And we got involved and transacted 45 properties as liquidity started to come back to the market. At the time, we thought we were reasonably clever selling into that liquidity, and we did well. But obviously, things have got so much better since. But I think that it's really important to go back and realize quite how illiquid that market was. And I don't think there's probably any northern Western European market where the investment turnover has gone up sevenfold in 5 years. Now, is that a function of the fact that the number of people in this room has doubled and there's four times as much capital, and it's just a function of quantitative easing across the world that, you know, somebody's got to find something to invest? Or is it actually the fundamentals of the Dutch market have changed? And I would say, please, a bit of both, but I think probably the Dutch market has changed more than other markets in terms of the amount of conversions from the old offices to be demolished or to hotels or residential. I think that has been a bigger factor in the Dutch market than most. And I think certainly the employment and the economy side has surprised everyone, including myself.
There can be a reason, there's a theory for that. The Dutch market is extremely transparent, and when the financial crisis occurred and when the office crisis occurred, there were relatively high vacancy numbers all over the market. But you should realize that all those broker reports are generally all over Europe and European focusing on CBDs, which would in Amsterdam be the South Axis, whilst in the Netherlands these reports have been covering the entire country. So, because of those negative numbers back then, the markets restructured heavily. And already in 2010-11, when I visited Provada, the former real estate investment companies were turned into redevelopment companies. And that enabled the markets to benefit from the recovery that came later. So, since the Netherlands has an open economy, it's the first economy that will benefit from global growth. And if that's combined with the redevelopment of the entire market, then there is room to benefit.
Can I just add something on that? I mean, you're exactly right, transparency of Dutch market, but one thing we shouldn't forget is that the Netherlands is so, demonstrated themselves as open for business and so welcoming to foreign investors, but not only that, to foreign companies and foreigners and expats moving in. People were actually, once they were, looking at alternative HQs and different locations and development of the skip hall and all that also impacted the demand rise in across Netherlands. I think that was a big key player, how the economy and the development of Dutch economy changed.
Yeah. I mean, when it comes to, the oversupply that we saw in markets and, under-demolished, and sure, vacancy rates of what, 17-18% in some markets like Hoofddorp, maybe even 30. That has changed, in my opinion. That has significantly changed. Stuff has been converted to other uses. It has actually been demolished, and the vacancy rates we see now are, in my opinion, quite healthy. That's a good thing. Now, I would be interested in your opinion as well. What I hear a lot is also, and I think, I hope I'm right with that impression, that sort of the planning regime or the planning approach has changed as well. Before, you had basically every sort of little community making their own planning decisions, and of course you would allow a big office development because you want jobs in your little community. And what I get feeling now is that most of the communities in the Netherlands are working closer together in terms of deciding where do we actually need new office space and what kind of development do we permit in Amsterdam. I think for it, I'm not sure if it's loosening now, but you know, last year I think you had to have a certain level of pre-leasing or pre-letting agreed before you could actually develop a building, unless you could show there's really demand for it. And I think that kind of planning change in planning regime, maybe also like the way you think about office development, that has changed, and I think that makes the market quite competitive going forward if that kind of level is maintained. The worst thing that can happen, in my opinion, is if you sort of like now see just, you know, a wave of new developments coming again, sort of unplanned, speculative, without any use, because then you get again into that situation where you just have too much supply in the market and the market.
So you're about to announce a wave of unplanned speculative developments. good, thank you. I'm going to dive in a little bit into the sectors here. I'm going to start with you, Arvi. Just because, thank you, David van Dyke, for this. So, you recently did a big deal in DIY, in the retail sector. And the question is this the new hidden gem that everybody should be seeking out?
DIY retail.
So, I guess it would be good to know why specifically that strand of retail. What was the idea behind it?
Yeah, I think why retail is obviously something that's spoken about a lot in today's world, especially the Internet of Things, Amazon, meaning that no one's ever going to shop in a store ever again. Well, it's going to do a click and it's in your postbox. Our view on that is, to some extent, that it's undeniable that impact is going to happen. It is happening. It's a boost in certain sectors like industrial logistics, but we think in certain defensive retail businesses, they're somewhat more resilient. And one of those, in our view, is DIY retail. It's quite instant. There's quite large items, which are logistically quite hard to shift around. So we see a lot of value in that space long term. The transaction we did was actually not on the list of the Q2 largest transactions. I think it was the largest transaction, but there you go. We bought 37.8 DIY stores dotted around the country. Our strategy is really looking at multiple facets of an investment. It's not just going, we like retail, we like office, or anything else. It's looking at how that fits into the economy, how the real estate fits into the sort of real estate developments in the market. And as an example, in that transaction, we had a defensive company, or an industry, I should say. We had a company that was a market leader, been operating for many years. They know the consumer, they know the trends, they're adapting to the trends. But also we had real estate that was actually quite flexible. While it is retail, these are in infill locations, they're in urban centers, as population is growing, the land value starts to have alternative use, starts to see increase in value. With a trend towards e-commerce, you're looking at sites that can be used for last mile delivery. You know, these are the click and collect, whatever it might be. So it's really making sure that the fundamentals are there and it is somewhat future-proof to the extent we can use our crystal ball. So that's why we really entered the retail space. It was in that DIY transaction. It wasn't a concerted effort to do retail or concerted effort to do DIY retail. It was more the transaction emerged and it fitted our profile. We underwrote it and it made a lot of sense for us from a sort of a long-term 15, 20-year perspective.
What kind of yield are we talking?
Good enough for our funds. but what I will say is part of the reason, this is not for saying non-public information, it was part of a wider corporate transaction. That brought a lot of complexity. A lot of other people wouldn't be able, a lot of other funds might, or investors might not be able to enter into or underwrite such a complex transaction where there's certain capital commitments that had to be made that may be challenging for other parties. So I would say we were able to generate that extra nugget of yield that made it work for us.
I'd like to ask the panel's thoughts on the Dutch retail market in terms of the strength of the town centre versus out-of-town retail versus online shopping versus shopping centres, because my experience, having been a developer in the Netherlands for a long time, the town centres were well protected by the planning legislation. Dutch people don't like to get sucked into large corporate names. Do you think the Dutch high street is a safer bet and a more sustainable investment than other high streets in Europe maybe are? as a retail location.
It's probably generally true across a lot of Europe. I mean, I'll say from a bigger picture perspective, we obviously have a large amount of investments in the US and a very small amount of investment in retail for almost precisely this reason. Unregulated, overbuilt, and as you read any public report, it's being totally decimated. Whereas in Europe, we've always had this argument, exactly as you're saying, it's more regulated, you've got more sort of local authorities controlling areas, and I think that is a very important aspect. Retail in some shape or form will exist going down the line. I think there's a hesitance to add a lot and to do big developments, so that protects the space. And while we don't do shopping centers, I do see high streets and shopping centers, creative shopping centers that drive traffic towards them as being how retail is polarizing. And I'm just talking about big box DIY, but we see that slightly different. So I think that trend is there. So I do think high street, and I do think shopping malls where we don't invest in them are good spaces.
There are not that many large shopping malls in the Netherlands, that's one thing. And secondly, you've seen over the past years the trend of shopping center owners trying to transform the shopping centers into areas where things happen. Well, Dutch historical inner cities are basically already exactly that. So you should actually consider a city center, especially a historical city center, as a shopping center. With everything in it. So also there we see more coffee shops, obviously, and there is more. I can't say anything about future rents. That's the black box in this story. But apart from that, I'm quite convinced that the high streets will remain as it is, perhaps a bit shorter. Which I mean that the beginning and the end of the streets might be cut off and more centralized, because a long street you can't manage as a shopping center. A short street you may be able to organize that. So that would mean really A1. And that's going to stay what it is.
I think it's also in the culture of the Netherlands. It's more of a country where we have shopping streets rather than going to shopping centers. And I think that's something that's also in the culture of the Netherlands, that people tend to go to retail streets rather than to go to large shopping centers. Also, we only have a few. Yeah.
This also is for courses, isn't it? With retail across Europe, you know, like in Scandinavia, the shopping center is the place to go.
Yes.
Most of the time, it's pretty cold and you have everything in there anyway. In Southern Europe, people like to go to the shopping center because it's air-conditioned, you know, in the summer. And shopping is actually a leisure activity.
Yeah.
In the Netherlands, people like the high street. I think in Germany, you know, it's quite a mix. I must admit, I'm not a big fan of retail in the Netherlands. I know the fundamentals are good, population grows, you know, unemployment is low, consumer spending, and so on, so on. It's just not for us because, you know, acquiring high street assets is quite tedious, and, you know, the yields are very low. So for that kind of reason, it's not really what we are looking for. And to be honest, the big shopping centers are all in the hands of, you know, the big names, the listed companies, you know, Klaviyo, Levi, and so on. It's not a market where, you know, we can really get in. But some shopping centers are fantastic, and the way, you know, they've been going on about it is really fantastic. The point about DIY, I like that as well, to be honest, because it is somewhat internet immune, if you like, or at least more resistant to it. And the other thing I quite like when it comes to retail is grocery shopping. Because in the UK, yeah, it's quite common to order your food. That kind of stuff, in my opinion, does not really, or will not take off for another couple of years in places like Germany or the Netherlands. It's possible from a logistical perspective, but I think, you know, the consumer still wants to go into the supermarket and pick their goods, and they have no problem with doing that. So again, I think it's horses for courses, and wherever you are in Europe, you should just understand the consumer.
Okay, good. Let's pick up on some of the sections. I mean, it'd be interesting, just picking up on that point, in terms of e-commerce. I mean, you were mentioning, Dirk-Jan, there that everybody likes to go into the center of town in order to go shopping. Does that mean e-commerce, because in general people are living close to the center of the town, so therefore it's more convenient to do that? Does that mean e-commerce is going to be a slower growth? Will it hit the sort of heights that it's hitting in the UK, or just not? That's anybody's question. You can talk about your own personal, whether you have Amazon Prime or not, or whatever it might be.
This morning I read that last year 4 out of 5 Dutch people bought something on the internet last year. So I wonder why it would be slower than in the UK. Perhaps it's slower because that might be happening. I don't know the numbers about that, but obviously why not? Usually the UK is a year ahead.
Okay, good. And in terms of the, you also did a logistics deal. Is that picking up in general on the strength of logistics? Was that a specific deal? You've also got obviously the new Silk Road from China ending up in the Netherlands. Is that just a general play around logistics, or was that a specific play for the Netherlands for that portfolio?
So this refers to a, correct me if I'm wrong, a logistics building we acquired in the Port of Rotterdam a few years ago. We recently did a very large expansion at the site. That was a direct transaction with a company. It was more their strategy to be there that resulted in us doing the transaction, as it were. I'd say taking it in two aspects. In terms of logistics as a whole, it's a clear story. It has been for several years. E-commerce being a big driver, under supply across Europe being a big driver. I think as far as the Netherlands go, you're obviously centrally located in Europe. You've got the biggest port in Europe. Got a huge, easy transition of product, whether it's up north Scandinavia, whether it's down south, Germany, wherever it might be. So I think those drivers are good. And it's good that countries investing in the Port of Rotterdam. We are in the new development area. And you can see that in our transaction, the company that was there had a 10-year contract, I think it was, and they've clearly extended, the business is good, so they need the expansion, and that's where we were to add to that. But in terms of the e-commerce driving, yeah, it's clear. I think, comment on the last question, it's clear. E-commerce is going to be a big part of our lives going forward, no doubt. But there's definitely space, on the other point, for convenience retail, and retail will exist. It's not willy-nilly everywhere. It's going to be more strategic. And having defensive DIY, well, I like to think about that. Grocery, of course, people want convenience stores, they need to pick things up. And it also becomes ultimately a balancing act between logistics costs and retail rental costs, because that's what you're trading as a company. So at some point, 5,000 trucks or drones or whatever it is going through the center of Amsterdam, actually better to have a store. They will come some kind of balancing act on that front. But for now, everyone's talking about e-commerce and multi-story, technologies in one building and so on, and I guess that's what we'll probably see in the near term.
Okay, good. And Asli, let's take a quick look at what's happening in hotels, leisure, that side. A moratorium on development, I think, in Amsterdam to prevent new hotels being built. What impact is that having? Is it a good decision or a bad decision? And is that then having an impact on other areas? Does that mean that the focus is then moving to hotels in Rotterdam, Utrecht, wherever it may be? And the other point that would be good to pick up is how much have things like the sharing economy, you know, Airbnb, begun to affect the Dutch market?
How long time we have? So let's start with the moratorium. I think one of the things people need to understand is that Amsterdam has and always had a shortage on residential. They have a major issue with availability of residential properties. And this was one of the reasons why the moratorium was sort of kicked in. Not also, that's not the only reason, but it was one of the reasons. And today, people like us who couldn't develop and build hotels in Amsterdam, we've been looking at these alternative new sites that the city has earmarked for both office and hotels development. And on the back of that, they have very cleverly arranged all the transport links, creating a very nice web of connection north to south, east to west. So we developed our hotels in a region called Houthavens, which was probably 10 years ago, just covered in mud in some shipping containers. Today, it's a whole quarter with offices, hotels, our hotels, and residential, where our hotel is right next to the new headquarters of Tommy Hilfiger and Calvin Klein. They have this massive headquarters, and they're building two more right next to it, and they're gonna have something like, we currently have, I think, 2,000 people, and we can reach up to 3,000 people. That's just one company. And having built a hotel right there, obviously we're very happy. We're seeing that progressing. And the access to the center is about 10 minutes and just by one bus. There's no tram, there's no metro, but people still are traveling to this new quarters of Amsterdam, outside Amsterdam, to stay or to work or to live. So I think the moratorium was a wise decision, very wise decision, that helped the economy to grow outside Amsterdam. Amsterdam also, don't forget, has a major traffic problem. It's not, you don't have, you can't expand the city's roads. It is very much limited by the canals and the existing buildings. So by driving the all these hotels and offices slightly out and linking to different regions, help the economy to be able to expand. Now, today we're trying to buy a new place to live in Amsterdam because we're kind of outgrown our current apartment, maybe my other half, and we can't find a place to live. And that's, I'm going to link to the Airbnb for you, because Amsterdam was, I think, one of the first countries in Netherlands or cities in Europe that has kind of very high restrictions on Airbnb, which was purely because of this reason. There's a massive lack of residential, and that they wanted to avoid and ensure that the actual people who need to live and work in Amsterdam can have homes and flats and places to live. So I can go into why Airbnb also was very good for the hotel business, but maybe we'll save that for the next conversation.
Okay, we'll do a special on hotels, that's what we'll do. And you're obviously living there as well, Rogier. What are you seeing, and I suppose as a bank, what are you prepared to underwrite outside of the main cities? Are you then looking at, so let's say there is a hotel development or an office development outside of the main centres. Is that something that you're now happy to underwrite, that maybe you weren't, that you can get through your credit committees?
Probably, because economically it would make sense. Tourism in Rotterdam, for example, grew by, I think, 37% last year. Amsterdam is a relatively small city. Urbanization is strong, tourism grows. You should focus at Randstad more than on Amsterdam only, taking into account the infrastructure and where people are going. And so therefore, development in Rotterdam, probably The Hague, perhaps Eindhoven, and small cities like Haarlem might work well.
Eindhoven is booming. I'm surprised seeing the increase, of course. It's never going to be like it very soon, but certainly alternative cities are...
Since last year, we're finally talking about the G5 instead of G4 in the Netherlands, yes. And number five is indeed Eindhoven. Which is interesting, but Rotterdam has put a lot of efforts in improving the attractiveness of the city for visitors, especially from abroad. It's nice to visit, there's enough office space, housing is cheaper, even though prices are increasing there as well, so you have to be quick. If I need any advice, you're welcome. So that is obviously an interesting city to invest. It's not a coincidence, by the way, that three of the four examples that you had in your several sheets were located in Rotterdam.
Okay, good.
I mean, if you look at the Netherlands anyway, getting from Rotterdam to Amsterdam is, what, a 30-minute train ride? That's what my commute is from southwest London into the city.
Yeah.
So
I
know we talk about different cities, but as you rightly said, I think it's a city region. People have that perception that Rotterdam is a different city, and yes, obviously it has its own characters and so on. But in terms of in terms of the overall size of the cities and how they are connected, it can feel like just one market in a way.
Yeah. And in terms of when you're looking at, let's say, the Netherlands versus Germany, you've got very different structures in terms of the cities. Do you see the G5, Holland Metropole, do you see that as a city in itself, in comparison to London or Paris or Madrid, or do you see it as a series of five separate cities? How do you view it?
We look at it as a region. You mentioned the Randstad region, that's obviously a key driver in it whenever we're looking at any investment in the Netherlands. There aren't that many countries in Europe that have multiple distinct regions. I think Germany, you mentioned, is probably the primary one that's fundamentally seven. They could be seven countries in terms of how much investment there is, in terms of how much business and local investors in each area, and their own major cities. I think we look at it as one region is saying, it's almost like a megalopolis, like investing Helsinki, you look at Helsinki, Espoo-Vantaa, it's similar dynamics. Obviously Amsterdam being, you know, the tightest yielding, the busiest, and then it spreads as you go out, but just like any other city you might invest in. But it is very sprawled, and I think that's that creates a lot of opportunity. We have offices in Eindhoven and that as well.
I think that also in general, international investors look at their red spend as a whole rather than Rotterdam, Amsterdam. I think it's more the national problem is that we have some difficulties in presenting ourselves as a red spend area rather than as Rotterdam and Amsterdam. Because there's still some sort of a bit of a struggle between the municipalities just to go out and present themselves as one whole.
It's good for us international investors.
But they also have very distinct sort of specialities in their own way. Like you look at Rotterdam and you have the whole, you know, the port and that kind of commerce, and then you look at Hague is more, you know, trade and NGOs and etc. And Eindhoven is really launching themselves as the science, you know, I don't know if you guys been to the science park. I was there about a week ago. The expansion of the science park, the creative industry, and all this AI and etc., as well as the Eindhoven airport. And when I talk about Deventer again, because I've been so pleasantly surprised when I went there, all that manufacturing, you know, ArcelorMittal has a massive location there, and it's on the German route, so the German highway is connected. It's when you dive in into each of these regions, you find this little part of such a unique investment opportunities or business drivers that. It's pleasantly surprising.
We mentioned earlier residential. Let's look a little bit at residential. Is that beginning to get too hot, do we think? Are there still opportunities there? I mean, I know personally for you. So I know you would like to talk down the market at this moment. But what's... What's your sense, Rogier? Let's look at it from the lending side for a moment. Are there things that how do you see residential at the moment from that perspective? Are there other sectors that you're keen to lend on and sectors that you're not keen to lend on?
That's a rough question. On resi in general, I mean, obviously, like every investor, we are very keen on expanding our loan book in resi. However, the availability is indeed limited, prices are high, and so is competition. So we do succeed in getting there, fortunately, and we have been expanding over the past years. There is still a great disbalance between supply and demand when it comes to RISI, and that's not going to change, just like that. Also here, I would say, go outside Amsterdam. In order, if you have the ability to be more creative and you have feet on the ground, try to get land and go up further into the value chain in order to participate in developments and these acquisitions, because it's probably the only way to buy in.
Okay, and let's just pick up a moment. I'm going to come back to the residential in a second. Let's pick up, because obviously everything has to run through your investment committee in Germany. So what's their view on the market moving more towards alternatives, whether that's parking, whether that's senior living, whether it's student housing? What's their sense of that? Do they buy into that story, or do they think that actually this is money just trying to chase high yield without thinking about it properly?
As a mortgage lender, we are very brick and mortar orientated. So when it comes to RISI and elderly housing or student housing, we basically view it as RISI and with some service in addition. And if a market would not function anymore because it's relatively new, you should be able to turn it around into, for example, nursed housing or whatever, or perhaps just an apartment for a smaller household. We've seen a lot of conversions over the past years, especially in student housing. And I haven't seen any recent numbers about the balance in that particular part of the market. We are trying to get more hesitant when it comes to the financing of, let's say, RISI, which still looks like an office on a B location. The question is, will that particular asset class still work if there's more balance between supply and demand? And that is also how we see it. Apart from that, alternative classes are no longer that alternative. The parking segment became mature, nursing housing became mature, hotels, you should see as a niche, it's very mature, so and I think as a landlord we can follow that, even though we are not sharing it.
Okay, good. And Dirk-Jan, just coming from your perspective, in terms of the residential, what are you seeing? Are you seeing different investors coming in, new investors coming in? What's the appetite like for residential as a sector?
I think in general it's still very, very high. And although there's a lack of supply, there are still a number of portfolios that are about to be sold in the next 6 months or so. In terms of investors, I think there's the competition between both international investors, there's also a very strong presence of domestic investors looking for those residential investments and developments. So it's both. It's you see a lot of very strong and Dutch investors that are aiming at those portfolios and doing the deals. As I think one of the examples given was Vesteda that just did a 1.5 billion. A deal in the Netherlands.
And one other quick question, just we mentioned Airbnb before. In London here, huge growth in WeWork co-working spaces. What's happening in the Netherlands? Is there a similar growth? How do you see that market, and do you think that's going to be having a big influence on the Dutch office market?
I think same in the Netherlands, they pop up everywhere. So I think also what I derive from reports is that the expectation is that that will still increase, and you have a number of suppliers in that area, but that is also still to increase. I think that the current level is at that 1% of the entire office space, and
actually 4%.
4%.
There was a survey lately, and apparently Amsterdam is, when it comes to Europe, it's one of the cities with the largest amount of working space.
Okay.
4% of stock.
I read somewhere that's expected to go up to 10 or
15. I think corporates love this kind of space, you know. Especially an upturn, you know, we have the flexibility, and I think that co-working and flexible working space is here to stay. I sometimes get a little bit more wary when I look at sort of like what's going to happen in sort of 7 years, 10 years, you know, when do we reach, will there be market saturation? What's going to happen then? You know, we have a lot of operators. It will be probably survival of the fittest or survival of the more most profitable one. I'm not sure which one that is. I think it's flexible working is here to stay, and it seems Amsterdam is one of the markets where it's like taking off incredibly fast. What it has done though is, what I've heard is that it makes leasing out very small floor plates of offices, like under 500 square meters, very difficult.
Yeah.
Because why would a company commit to a lease for 5 years or 10 years, you know, for 500 square meters if they could just move into a flexible space? So that's sort of impacting the market at that end, clearly.
But the market is currently struggling also at the other end of the spectrum, and apparently there's a massive shortage of big open place buildings in Amsterdam or around Amsterdam. People cannot find anything to put an office like this.
Yeah. I mean, a big brokerage company, big international brokerage company, without naming a name, they are converting at the moment an old sort of car showroom garage in Schinkelbühl. Yeah, you heard about it. Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, and it's like it's not really an office that much. I know why they're going there, because they want to harvest the sort of the creative talent and get sort of that kind of place. But also because that kind of space you can't really lease, you need to create it for yourself. So they're going to have sort of some co-working space there. There's going to be cafes or a client showroom and so on. You're right, you know. So leasing small space is sort of competition with sort of flexible operators. Finding large spaces is very difficult. You know, take the example of the Schroders, you know, not the World Trade Center, the Atrium, the extensions. Booking.com swooped them up before, you know, it actually came to the market. So incredible, yeah.
And Amsterdam is at 4%.
4% of stock, apparently.
And we're in London right now?
I don't know, probably 2. It's a much larger market.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. I mean, WeWork is a huge occupier here. You only just have to walk around the city and you can see just how major it is. So it'll be interesting to see how that moves. I want to pick up that point, which is really also partly about availability of stock, both as an occupier but also as an investor. In your space, Arvi, you mentioned slightly earlier that it's getting slightly more difficult. Does that mean you're having to change your strategy at all in terms of where you're looking to get the returns that you want in the Dutch market? Are you moving to different cities or moving to different types of assets?
Like I said earlier, I think as markets tighten up and yields go down and competition increases, you have to, you know, broaden your spectrum of where you're looking and what you're looking at. I think that's kind of a natural trend. We've never been a prime buyer, inherently by our nature, structure, and requirements. So we've always been looking in, I'd say, generally more regional or out of favor is maybe not the right term to use. I think it's let's call it less in demand locations, because that really generates some yield, and it's the same with the asset classes as well. So I think we're still looking. We have to keep our ears and eyes open for whatever they might be, but. As I said earlier, you know, the deals we've done have been somewhat creative, and that's allowed us to find those investments. But yeah, the dynamics of Amsterdam city center retail or office certainly has an impact overall for the country, but doesn't, you know, directly impact us as a fund.
Okay, good. I'm going to pick that up a little bit in a minute, but this all sounds as though it's, you know, sunshine and blue skies. For the rest of time immemorial in the Dutch market. So what are you seeing? You know, you're obviously looking at risks, you're looking at those. What do you see as the potential risks? What are you taking into your consideration when you're looking at the market, especially given that, you know, everybody thought that the market this year would be down on 2017's. Do you see this, the fact that we're going to be the same in 2018 as a potential issue? Do you see that staying the same for 2019 or going back to normal? Or, you know, how do you see the market?
Again, the information I get is, of course, just of the deals that we are involved in. I, at very short term, I don't see that really going back. If I just look at the work that comes in at our offices and the number of investors, and also the different investors that are looking at the Dutch market, I don't see that changing very soon, at least not in the next 6 to 9 months or so. After that, I'm not sure.
Okay, and in terms of,
Yeah, I mean, you said, you know, yeah, at the moment, I think we should be happy the sun's shining over the Netherlands, and that's, you know, something we haven't seen in a while, and I think, you know, it's time to enjoy it a little bit. You know, good occupier demand, low vacancy, rents rising, you know, that's all good. I think in sort of 2, 3, 4 years' time, I think, you know, we're going to see lower growth across Europe anyway. The Netherlands is a very open economy. It's an economy that is very international and very trade-driven. So one of the risks I could see, for example, is an impact of trade wars. You know, if we see sort of a lower level of international trade, that will surely affect an economy like the Netherlands. And I think also that like a lot of other economies in Europe are somewhat dependent on, you know, how well Germany performs and how well France performs. So if we see a slowdown in that, yeah, things will settle in the Netherlands as well. I think, you know, we are sort of in the middle of the swing, but I think, you know, in 2 to 3 years' time, this dynamic will sort of slow. It's just how it is.
Okay, good. I just wanted to pick up on one point related to regulation. We've mentioned the zoning. We've mentioned the fact that the government is, and the cities are trying to regulate the zoning much more. Is there anything in terms of regulation, tax, those kinds of things, probably to you, Dirk-Jan, that investors from outside should be thinking about, whether it's a change or whether it's a potential impact?
Well, I think there are a number of changes in regulations. So one thing that's definitely something a lot of people talk about is the rules that are set by the municipality of Amsterdam in respect of residential development. So there's also requirements of regulated rent, part of that development that has to relate to regulated rent, it needs to be rented out regulated. So that's definitely something that is something that also might change and even require more regulated rent in new development. So that's definitely something that could change the dynamics in residential developments also in Amsterdam. Make it feasible for certain developers to pick up those projects. I think, as Rogier pointed out, there are some, the government presented the budget yesterday, a number of new tax regulations were presented, one of them being the dividend tax being cancelled, which will have a effect on international investors. So that's definitely the second one.
Taking away from the expats, though.
Yeah. So these are things that pop into my mind now.
Actually, to add something to the regulation of the city of Amsterdam, that pushes developers also out of the city, which means that there is more development activity outside of Amsterdam, especially in the areas like Hoofddorp and something, which is not subject to the same regulation.
Hoofddorp literally pitched for six different, a couple of them being conversion and a couple of them greenfield development of hotels. And I mean, the difference the developer looked at it, the return profile between what I can give him on a 25-year lease versus what he's getting on a 5-year office lease is just like, literally, it's like, goodbye. It's not even hard. We couldn't even negotiate it. The gap is so much. And now you've seen all the cranes moving out of the street and going up to Hoofddorp and beyond Hoofddorp, where the non-is HQ is being built and et cetera. It's very interesting. Equally, the downside of it is that I've seen it's coming to a tipping point about construction costs in Netherlands as well. So there is, I think, if we are going to talk some risks and worries, it's not that bad, but we can certainly see a conversion a project I looked in Haiti and sort of cost that in somewhere in the early last year when we start negotiation, where we come to now sort of going to nitty gritty bit, it's just like 17%, and that's not even the final bit of it. So I see that becoming a slight problem, and in return, what I've seen is that I visited four or five independent, different modular building factories in the Netherlands, and they're still coming up with some quite interesting methodologies and speed and way of rolling out this manufacturing, modular manufacturing. So, and I've seen developers now bringing those into equation. So, quite a lot of movements happening in the creative development and where they develop and type of development they're doing.
It's also underlined that you need a good advisor.
Yeah.
When it comes to regulation. Especially when it comes to Dutch REITs. And it combined with corporate tax and dividend tax. Corporate tax will go down, by the way. Two steps in the coming 2 years. But obviously something will come in return of it to compensate for that. So hire a good tax lawyer.
Okay, good. I'm sure there'll be either one here or we can find one for you. Now, we've done very well because we haven't mentioned Brexit at all so far. Brexit dividend for any of the Dutch cities? Yes, no? Do we see any? There was an anticipation from Amsterdam, certainly, that they would gain a lot of jobs, but do we see that? Are we seeing it?
Certainly, we see that all these developments have been introduced and what's coming through.
Well, there's a couple of Japanese banks that announced, you know, that they're going to Amsterdam, which makes complete sense. You know, we have Schiphol Airport, you know, which connects very well with the rest of the world and Asia. In terms of, I keep confusing them. Which one is going? Is it the European Medical
Association?
Yeah, they are going.
30,000 room nights,
yep.
Hotel room nights.
Yep.
So I literally moved out from London and put it right with me.
So I think Amsterdam is benefiting, but it's not at the scale of like Frankfurt or Paris in terms of the international attractions. But yeah, I think it does. Now the question is, what's going to happen to trade? That is something, you know, that is important for the Netherlands, and you know, Rotterdam is the largest port internationally. Lots of stuff goes over the channel anyway. I don't know. I don't want to. I mean, my gut feeling says we will get some sort of agreement on trade, and you know, it's just sort of the geographics of the Netherlands. It's just close to there, so there will still be goods going through. Would it be a benefit for the Netherlands, or will it be sort of a problem? I'm not really sure about that.
And it's interesting because I picked that up because a question came in, which was, do you think it could be seen as the sort of more kind of friendly base for occupiers? Because English is a common language, it's quite a transparent market in some ways. You said a definite yes, Arvi, so to that. So.
Well, I think entire Europe's frankly benefiting from it, and a lot of locations for different reasons. We set up an office in Amsterdam. It's, our asset management's entirely based there for Europe. In 2008, for obviously Waybury Brexit and everything else, but you know, primarily because good location. Obviously, as a corporate, it's a good place to be for corporate reasons. But the more importantly, for actual function and work, there's a good pool of workforce. There's reasonable labor costs relative to somewhere like London, particularly. There's great access to traveling around Europe. It's incredible to me that you can get off your plane and be in the World Trade Center offices in 6 minutes.
Yeah.
In 6 minutes, you barely get through security at Heathrow. Overall,
you still wait for the bus.
Yeah, so those things are really there, so they can only benefit as many other, you know, Frankfurts and Paris's or Warsaw or whoever are benefiting. I think Amsterdam will get its piece of the pie. And it will be quite permanent when people realize that it's, you know, the shock of moving and then it's there and then realize how great a place it is.
And it's not. It's also a horizon, you know, like it might not happen over the next 12 months after Brexit. Look at 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, you know.
The longer the chaos prevails, I mean, who knows what's going to happen, but if it's... No, but this is people... Companies fundamentally dislike uncertainty.
Absolutely.
Investors dislike uncertainty. And while this annoying continuation of uncertainty carries on, over time, more and more will just move. People get fed up, will just go. And that's when, you know, when they're negotiating all these exciting Brexit conditions and X, Y, and Z, and when people start to realize that perhaps actually the small annoyances in life start to get the better of you.
Yeah.
Whether it's queuing for an extra 20 minutes of passport control, something that no one paid any attention to, it starts to drive people away. There's 240 odd other countries in the world to be. I'm staying here. But
yeah.
Well, that's a good question. Positive note.
Yeah. But also, Richard, for those institutions that tend to move to the Netherlands, they also should have a positive.
Yeah.
Because Amsterdam is basically full. There's no space left over here. So it's not going to last forever either. And it's probably cheaper right now. Being from Schiphol Airport at 20 minutes distance.
Yeah.
So that's.
And it's great.
Yeah, I mean, you see that already, you know, there are companies who, you know, can't find space and so on, so a little bit fed up with sort of, you know, just, well, not finding the right space in Amsterdam. You know, they have no problem with going to Tech City Center. And what happened around the new station is amazing. I mean, Richard, you know it best because you just moved there with, you know, the World Trade Center and what's going on around that area. And that is, what, is it 17 minutes from, or something like that, 15 minutes from Amsterdam Central, the Trade Center? Again, you know, that's if you come from Southwest London to the city, my commute on the tube is longer. So
30 minutes to the Schiphol.
Yeah, I mean that is a big development there.
Yeah.
So, and does seem to be proving that the Holland Metropole idea actually does work. I would like to say that having consistently had to go to Amsterdam for a long period of time, it does depend what runway you land.
Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes you feel as though you've actually landed in Berlin or somewhere rather than anywhere else.
Take
the we won't go over that. Yields is the only way up, or can they go down again? Yaz and the plastic population, I think the only way is up. So what do we think? Just a quick one each. Yields, up, down, stay the same?
What horizon?
Until we're here next year, so 12 months.
Okay, stable. Yeah, European Central Bank interest rates, you know, at the moment, our house view is we will see two moves in 2019, late 2019. I've seen very more pessimistic economists who say, you know, it might even go up longer. I don't think any interest rate increase will have a massive impact on property yields. There will be some, but it's, we're not talking about a massive move for outwards. So for, if you just look for a year ahead, it's probably stable. I can't see how yields in Amsterdam are going even lower for prime, sorry. In other segments of the markets, office markets, there might be a little bit more. I mean, we've been bidding on something where I was pretty certain about what kind of offer we should make, what kind of deal we should put in, and we got up it. Happens. So Amsterdam prime, for example, for the next year stable. After that, you might see just a very slight upward movement. But the weight of money, you know, is still there. And if you look at fundamentals like population growth, that is still going to attract investors, so stable.
Okay, up, stable, down.
In the coming 12 months,
yeah.
Fine. A little bit down.
Okay.
Secondary, even stronger, especially in those locations outside Amsterdam, which we just discussed. The open potential is there.
Okay, Harvey?
Yeah, I'd agree on a 12 month basis. You know, prime, can, there's still a little space to go down, even as rates. Moving up, the yield rate spread is still huge. If history tells us anything, we run a few years behind the US, you see what's happening there. So yeah, on 12 months, flat down. And as you say, in the alternatives, there's still scope to compress with the weight of capital coming into Europe.
Okay.
I'll follow the experts on this, so I can stay.
Okay.
Completely agree, and I think the only market watching that movement there is the secondary market in outside.
Okay, good. And the last one, which is where should these people invest? What are your tips? I know you're going to say definitely not three bedroom apartments.
Yeah,
you don't want any competition.
In Amsterdam.
What's your sense of where the opportunities are at the moment?
To be honest, today I will put my money on the land, just a few land along the highways.
Okay, land on the highways. Dirk-Jan?
I would think logistics still, but also development, so for sure land, but also residential development.
Okay, great. Harvey?
As a long-term investor, I'd say obviously land is a good place to be, but in any kind of real estate where you can really if you get comfortable with a 10, 20 year horizon that it will ride through all the way and it has a long term prospect.
Okay. Interesting question. Of course, land, but I would say especially within the city rings of those, let's say, top 20 cities. And I would also say that the country is in need of some better quality offices in these secondary cities. So you've seen that where we have been under the knowledge, we might now be underdeveloped since development has basically come to a standstill 10 years ago. And it shows in the meanwhile in the market, because there are quite a few office buildings that basically good locations of having been built in the 1990s. And these definitely need some attention. There is a market that you can buy them in an quite stake right now, so you will buy cash, and if you can upgrade these, then you might have a very interesting investment for the future.
Okay, good. Ollie?
For me, it's basically Amsterdam offices, not necessarily in the city center of the Zuiders, just because where yields are. I find emerging locations interesting, as I said before, Southeast Arena, maybe Sloterdijk, slots. I mean, if you look at planning, what the plans are for Sloterdijk, that could be interesting. I know at the moment it's not really attractive, but in the central areas at Rund train station, that could be interesting. Then it's city center Rotterdam, city center Utrecht, and logistics in the south, like logistics in the Brabant area.
Okay, good.